Now we have covered locks and semaphores. Now we are about to cover a third construct, a third synchronization construct, which is the monitor. Okay? And the monitor is basically a higher level abstraction than a semaphore. Before we do that, we'll just look into some examples of what are the bad consequences of making mistakes with semaphores. So when you protect a critical section with a semaphore, you want to do wait on semaphore, then critical section, then post the semaphore. But what if you do post? What if you make a mistake and you do post X, critical section, wait X? So in this case, what will happen? You do post critical section wait. So here we're saying wait if there is an instance of the resource available. If there is no instance, wait. And here post, release an instance of the resource. Here we're saying release an instance of the resource, which means that this process will access the critical section anyway, right? And then wait. So if a process does this, it will not only access the critical section without checking on other processes, it will also make another instance available. So it will allow another process to access the critical section. So with this, you may have multiple processes in the critical section. Because if the initial value of X is 1, then this is going to make it 2. Post is going to increment. Remember, post increment, wait decrement. So this is going to increment this and we'll make it 2. And then other processes may access the critical section. Now what if you do this? Wait on X, critical section, wait on X. What will this cause? What's the bad consequence of this, of doing this? Yeah.
Does it cause its own deadlock?
Yeah, exactly. So it would be deadlocking on itself. So it's X is 1, right? So this will take the critical section and make it 0, but then it will be waiting on X because it will find it 0, and it will be waiting forever because it will be waiting for itself. No one is releasing, no one is increasing the number of instances of that resource. So this is just to understand what bad things may happen if we don't use semaphores correctly. So monitors were introduced to be to provide a higher level of abstraction that will basically give you an automatic way of solving the critical section problem. Automatic in the sense that the monitor is an object used for synchronization, and the most important property of this object is that only one process can be in the monitor at any given point in time. So you are guaranteed by the system that only one process can be in the monitor at any given point in time. So the monitor has a queue. A monitor has a queue that guarantees that only one process can be in the monitor. So if multiple processes are trying to access the monitor, one of them will be in the monitor and the rest of them will be in the queue. This will automatically solve the critical section problem. Okay? So the monitor, you can think of the monitor as an object, as an object-oriented an object-oriented class that has shared data and methods. But it has a queue in addition to a regular, unlike a regular object, this is a special kind of object that has a queue that guarantees that only one process or one thread can be in the monitor at any given point in time. Now, does this solve all the optimization, all the synchronization problems that we want to solve? Is this enough to solve all the problems? Well, it's the problems that we have seen, different kinds of problems. Not all problems are simply, you know, critical section problems where you want to protect shared variables. Synchronization problems have include dependence type of problems. So this is not enough. We need other constructs, or we need other mechanisms for solving more complex synchronization problems. And that's why a monitor has condition variable. What's a condition variable? It's just like a semaphore. So it's a semaphore inside the monitor. So basically the monitor is a package. It's an abstract data type that has in it, that can package multiple semaphores, plus, you know, the queue that guarantees that only one process will be in the monitor. So it's giving you a critical section. Anything in the monitor is by definition a critical section, and it's giving you it allows you to define one or more condition variables, one or more semaphores that can be used to solve synchronization problems. So it's a package. Okay? And these condition variables are very much work like semaphores. So we have a wait and a signal operation on each condition variable. And each condition variable has its own queue. So now, in a monitor, we have multiple queues. We have the main queue that controls access to the monitor, that guarantees that, or that is used to ensure that only one process will be in the monitor. And each variable, each condition variable has its own queue. So if a process is waiting on variable X, then it's in the queue for variable X. If a process is waiting for variable Y, it's in the queue for variable Y. Okay. Now with condition variables, there is one issue that we need to understand about condition variables, and this doesn't mean much for us as users of monitors. It's an implementation or a design decision of a monitor. When a process does signal, so that process is in the monitor, it does a signal, it means that there is another process that has been waiting for that signal. So now at this point, which process should proceed? The one that signaled or the one that has been waiting? So this is a design decision. So you can signal and wait. So let the process that has been waiting proceed first, or signal and continue, and let the other process wait. So this is an implementation decision. That doesn't mean much for us as users of the monitor. Now we will describe a solution to the dining philosopher's problem with using monitors. Now in this solution, we will have two operations, pick up and put down, and each one of them is based on a test operation. Okay. And there is some initialization code that will just set the state of each philosopher to thinking. So each philosopher can be in one of three possible states: thinking, hungry, or eating. And we have an array of states. So each philosopher has an entry in that array. And we have an array of condition variables. Each philosopher has his own condition variable that he will be waiting on if he cannot eat. Okay, the way this is used is like this. So when a philosopher needs to eat, he's gonna do pick up the chopsticks, and if the chopsticks for that philosopher are not available, he's gonna be blocked inside of this pickup. So he'll be waiting in his own he will be waiting in the queue for his own queue, the queue for his condition variable. And eventually he will get the chopsticks, and then he will be eating. Now eating, when a philosopher is eating, he's outside the monitor now. Because in the context of processes and resources, eating means use the resources. Right? So this is acquire the resources, use the resources, and this could be a fairly long process. Right? So it's what the process does with these resources, this can take a long period of time. Then when the process is done, it's going to do put down. So the point here is that you are in the monitor when you are picking up or putting down, but when you are processing the resource, you are not in the monitor. Okay, so now let's describe the solution. So what's pickup? Pickup, the philosopher will put himself in the hungry state. Then he's going to test on I. So he's going to do a test. What does test on I do? We will look into test in more detail in a minute. But for now, what test does is that it checks on both neighbors. If both of them are hungry, then this philosopher will put him will not change his state, but he will put himself in the waiting state or in the waiting for his own condition variable. So if both neighbors are not eating, or if none of the neighbors is eating, then test is going to set the state of the philosopher to eating. If it doesn't set it to eating, this means that one of the neighbors is eating, in which case the philosopher will put himself in the waiting state for his own condition variable. Okay? Now, put down, what does put down do? Put down, when the philosopher is done, he's going to change his own state to thinking, so he's no longer hungry, he's no longer eating. Then he's going to do test I plus 4 mod 5, test I plus 1 mod 5. What does this mean? What's I plus 1 and I plus 4?
Left and right.
Left and right? Yeah, these are the neighbors, right? So if your number 0, then your neighbors are I plus 1 and I minus 1. These are your neighbors. But we do it in a circular manner. I plus 1 is I plus 1 mod 5, and I minus 1 is I minus 1 mod 5. But I minus 1 mod 5 is equal to I plus 4 mod 5. Why? Because this is circular. So what's I minus 1? I minus 1 is going one step counterclockwise here. So this is I minus 1. One step counterclockwise is the same as going four steps clockwise in the other direction. So 1, 2, 3, 4. So whether you do minus 1 or plus 4, it's the same thing when you are in a circle. Okay? So I plus 4 is the same as I minus 1. So this means check on both neighbors to see if they have been waiting and they can now eat. So when 0 puts down the chopstick, he's going to do test on 1, and he's going to do test on 4. When 0 does a put down, he's going to test on 1, and he's going to test on 4. And what does test on 1 do? Test on 1 is going to check on 0 and 2. And test on 4 is going to check on 0 and 3. So let's look at test now. So what test does is that it will check on neighbors, I plus 1 and I plus 4, and see if they are not eating. If both neighbors are not eating, and the philosopher that is being checked on is hungry, then the philosopher that we are checking on, which is philosopher I, is now ready to eat. So we will change the state of philosopher I to eating. And we will signal philosopher I. So now, what's the point in signaling philosopher I? Why is this signal necessary? Now, who will call test? If you recall from the previous slide, who calls test is called in two different places. It can be either called by the philosopher himself, or it can be called by a neighbor, right? So in which case do we need the signal? When it's called by the philosopher himself, or when it's called by a neighbor?
By neighbors.
Yeah, when it's called by a neighbor. Because when it's called by the philosopher himself, I don't need a signal because the philosopher is not waiting. He's going to put himself in the hungry state, and then he will test on both neighbors. And if both neighbors are not eating, then he's going to put himself in the eating state, and signaling is not necessary here. Right? But signaling is necessary when a philosopher checks on both neighbors. Now, when zero checks on his neighbors, on one and four, he's going to check if one has been waiting, then one will be waiting in his own waiting on his own condition variable. And now we need to wake up one. So this guy has been waiting. We need to wake up philosopher one by doing a signal. Okay. So signal is needed when a philosopher is checking on his neighbors. Now the question is, why do we need to check state of I is hungry? And what will happen if we don't do this? Why can't we just delete? What if I delete this? What will happen? Why is this needed? Again, is it needed when test is called by the philosopher himself? Or is it needed when test is called by a neighbor? Okay, so now what will happen if we do this? Zero does pick up and then eats, because all of them are available. All chopsticks are available. Then zero does put down, and it will check on both neighbors. It will check on one and four. And when it checks on one, we're checking on one now, we check on both neighbors of one, and the neighbors of one are 0 and 2. And none of them is eating. So in this case, we will change the state of 1 to eat. Is this right or wrong?
It's right.
Why? Because test is not even, 1 is not even hungry. So what will happen if you change the state of a philosopher to eating when he's not even hungry? He hasn't been waiting for the chopsticks. What's wrong with this? What's the problem with this? Well, now we're not talking about philosophers. So it's in real life. I mean, it's like, you know, someone is thinking and you force them to eat when they're not hungry, so they would be upset. Okay, but in the context of processes and resources, what's wrong with making a process eat when the process is not hungry? Now, in the context of processes, what does hungry mean?
Need a resource.
The process needs the resource. So when you make the process eat, you are giving the resource to a process that is not requesting it. Mm-hmm. And when you are giving a resource to a process that is not requesting it, you are wasting resources. And in fact, in this case, you may never get it back, because if you give it to this process and this process never does any monitor operation, this resource will never get reclaimed. Mm-hmm. Yes?
Can this result in starvation for a different process that's waiting?
Yeah, so this we'll discuss this in a minute. Yeah, this will cause starvation. Yeah, this solution may cause starvation. Okay, but now do we understand why we need this hungry here? Yeah, we don't want to give the resource to a process that is not requesting. Now, in terms of deadlocks and starvation, before we talk about starvation, let's talk about deadlocks. Can deadlocks happen here, and why? Can we have a deadlock here, and why? Okay? So the answer is no. We cannot have deadlocks, but why?
Because each philosopher's actions are dependent on its neighbor's states.
On its state? Well, you know, when you say it's dependent, so this means that deadlocks are unlikely. So deadlocks happen because of dependencies. If each one is depending on the other, it's like mutual dependencies cause deadlocks. But here, we cannot have a deadlock because of the most fundamental property of a monitor, which is what? Yeah.
Only one is going to be at the table at a time?
Not at the table, but in the monitor. Only one process can be in the monitor at any given point in time, which means that when a process is doing this test, it will not get interrupted. Again, it will not get interrupted. It doesn't mean that it will not lose the CPU, but it means that this will be in the monitor. It will get to check on both neighbors, and it will change its state to eating only if both chopsticks are available. So we are guaranteed to check on both without getting interrupted by another process that is trying to acquire the resources. Okay? So that's why deadlocks. Deadlocks do not happen here because only one process can be in the monitor. Now, can starvation happen? Yes. The answer is yes. And here is a scenario that will cause starvation, or in which starvation will happen. If process zero does pick up, of course, initially all resources are available. So when zero does pick up, no problem, it will get to eat. Now, if process number four does pick up, what will happen? Well, 4 will check on both neighbors. 4 will eat only if both neighbors are not eating, but now 0 is eating. So 4 cannot get the chopsticks, so 4 will be waiting. So 4 will do pickup, then wait. Now wait in which queue? In the monitor queue? No, not in the monitor queue. In the condition variable queue. The queue for the condition variable. So wait the condition variable queue. Now what if what if 3 does pick up? Will it find both chopsticks available?
Yes,
both are available, so it will get to eat. Okay. Then, what if 0 is done? Eventually, 0 will be done. 0 is done and does put down. Now, when 0 does a put down, it will check on both of its neighbors. It will check on 1. Are both chopsticks available for 1 now? Yes, but 1 is not hungry, so nothing will happen. Right. Now, it will check on 4. Are both chopsticks available for 4?
No.
So again, 4 will not get to eat now. So 0 will just put down, and this will not cause any other process to eat. But then, what if 0 gets hungry again, and 0 does a pickup again? Will it get to eat?
Yeah.
Because both resources are available. So 0 will eat again. Okay. Then, what if 3 does put down? When 3 does put down, it's going to check on both neighbors. It will check on 2. For 2, both resources are available, but 2 is not hungry. It's not requesting the resource. It will check on 4. Are both resources available? No, because 0 has this chopstick. So again, 4 will not eat. So if these, 0 and 3 keep getting hungry, then 3 will never eat. So basically, if for one philosopher, if both neighbors are pigs, then you will never get to eat. And the solution is not setting a limit on how many times these 0 and 3 will keep getting the chopsticks. without, while W is waiting. This is exactly what starvation is. You are waiting, and there is no limit on the number of turns that other processes can get while you are eating, while you are waiting. Okay, so this is starvation. Thank you.